السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلي وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، ما بعد. طيب، we reached to a point that is it compulsory to use the water in purifying the najasa and removing the najasa if there is urine on the table, for example, or on my dishdasha, on my dress? Is it a must to use the water, or it is okay to use anything other than the water? Many scholars said you have to use the water, like what is alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah, the madhab of Imam Ahmed, and also it is famous among the Maliki madhab and the Shafi'i madhab also, or the old Shafi'i madhab, because if you remember we mentioned Shafi'i has madhab al-qadim and madhab al-jadid, madhab al-qadim and madhab al-jadid, the old Shafi'i madhab and the new Shafi'i madhab. When he shifted from one place to another place, يعني he has different madhab. They said you have to use the water. Why? Because Allah says in the Quran, وَيُنَزِّلُ عَلَيْكُم مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِّرَكُم بِهِ. Allah gave you water from the sama to purify you. So they said, Allah mentioned the Quran that the water is to purify you. طيب, and also they mentioned the famous hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told the companions, bring a pot of water to clean the urine in the masjid. You know the famous story when a man urinated in the masjid. طيب, and the Prophet ﷺ also was asked about the dishes and the plates of the kuffar. Can we use them or not? He said, wash them, then use it. Use these plates. So they say, the group of scholars, it means this is wajib to use the water. And the other opinion, madhab Abu Hanifa, and also it is an opinion in the madhab Imam Malik, and also Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, and the old opinion of Ibn Shafi'i, also the opinion of Shaykh Islam Ibn Uthaymeen, they said the water and also anything other than water, it can be used to purify and to clean. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. They said why? They said about the ayah and the hadith. Okay, Allah said the water is to purify you, but Allah did not say only the water which purifies you. Okay, there is a difference. Okay, when I say the water, use the water to purify yourself, it doesn't mean it is different than use only the water to purify you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention that the water only. طيب, and also when he said about the urine in the masjid, because this is easy and available for everyone to use the water. طيب, and also if you remember last week we mentioned, what is the way to purify the shoes before entering the masjid?
Dust.
The dust. Dust. Okay, and also the tail of the woman, I mean the tail of the abaya of the woman, the dust, the ground. So يعني, they said not necessary to use the water, but no doubt the water is available. Usually it is available more than everything. Okay, so they said it is not a must to use the water. طيب, and يعني, this is يعني, it's a stronger opinion, wallahu alam, that using anything other than the water, using anything other than water, okay, will be acceptable to clean and to purify your place, your body, or your clothes. And يعني, also they said, this is agreed upon all the scholars, if there is khamr, according if you remember, according to majority of scholars who said the khamr is najis. They said if the khamr by itself converts to vinegar, it is halal and tahir. Okay? Without using water. Yani, you know, maybe process. By heat, process like, not processed by a man himself. Okay? By itself. If it converts to khal vinegar, it will be no doubt pure, yani tahir. All the scholars said this. Okay, so this is a strong opinion that using anything other than the water, of course, anything pure, anything tahir, it is not allowed to use the najis to remove the najis. Okay, it is not allowed to use the filth to remove the filth. Means using something tahir, something tahir. This issue is important because nowadays how do we wash our clothes? We put them in the machine, صح? And we mix sabun and mai, soap and water. So together they are mixed. So according to the first opinion, this will not purify. If you want to follow the first opinion, I mean for those people who are following the first opinion, they believe this process is not enough to purify that, your dress. Why? Because if you mix the water and tide and these things, Oma and these things, okay? No doubt, this is not pure water. I mean, it is not plain water. It is mixed. So you have to wash it by water at the beginning or at the end. You have to use water alone, according to the first opinion. Why? Because this will not purify your clothes. But according to the second, it's okay. Why? Because no doubt using these chemicals would stronger than the water. Stronger than the water. Right? So inshallah, this is the strong opinion that using anything other than water which can clean is enough. طيب. They mention a point here. It is not allowed to use the food. It is not allowed to use the food or our drinks to remove the najasa. Okay. Yani maybe using the juice would remove the najasa. But this is haram, why? Because the juice to drink. If you use the juice to remove the najasa, you are wasting the juice. Okay, we have to respect the ni'mah. We have to respect the food, because the food to eat and to drink, yes, of course, also the water to drink, but the water for drink and for clean. But the food is only to eat. The drink to the juice to drink, and yani subhanallah, the food of the jinn is not allowed to clean the najasa. Yeah. So the same thing, our food is not allowed to clean the najasa. Then we go to the next chapter, which is called al-istinja. Al-istinja. طيب. Al-istinja, what does it mean? Istinja? Istinja, it is a word originally from al-najw. Al-najw, to cut. There is a tree, and you cut the tree, we say najw. Okay, why they mention this word al-istinja? It means to cut the najasa, to stop, yani, to do something to stop the najasa after that, or to clean the najasa after that. They mean, after the toilet, you have to clean the place of the najasa. The urine or the other najasa. What is the ruling of al-istinja, to clean yourself after the najasa? I mean, yani, after the urine or the other one. This is wajib. You have to clean yourself. You have to clean yourself. This is wajib. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, if you go to the toilet, use three stones. فإنها تجزي عنه. It is enough for you. So we have two ways to clean ourselves after the toilet. Either we use the water or the stone, or what is like the stone, the tissue they mentioned, the wood, يعني something which is acceptable and not haram. So this is the ruling of الاستنجاء. You have to. How can we do the استنجاء to clean yourself after the toilet? Number one, the stone. And what is like the stone? What is the proof? The proof, the hadith I mentioned. The Prophet ﷺ said, use three stones. And this hadith also, it means it is not allowed to use less than three. Minimum three. And some scholars said, if the stone is big enough, and you can use three corners of this stone, also this is enough. If the stone is big enough, okay, you can use يعني, three sides of the stone, also this is enough. And also the hadith, Sahih Muslim, Salman al-Farisi said, the Prophet ﷺ forbade us to use less than three stones. Okay, if it is not, if you are not, until now, not clean after using three stones, what should you do? You have to use more than three stones. And it is recommended to be water, odd number. The minimum is three. The minimum three, not one. One is an odd number, but this is not enough. Okay, and also two, not enough. So at least you use three. If it's still you are not clean, use
five.
Four and five. Yeah, sorry, yani four, and also you have to add five. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, من استجمر فليوتر. من استجمر فليوتر. What does it mean, من استجمر? If you use the stones to clean yourself, so use the witr number. What does it mean, witr? 1, 3, 5, 7. But of course, one not acceptable. Why? Because we have another hadith which says
minimum three.
طيب من استجمر فليوتر. And also about the using the stones, the Prophet ﷺ said, don't use rawth and don't use العظام. Rawth is the stool of the animals. It's not allowed. And العظام, the bone. Also, this is not allowed. And there is another narration. Don't use rawth. عظام, the stool of the animals. عظام, the bones. And also حمامة. حمامة. What is the meaning of حمامة? The coal. فحم.
Coal.
فحم. You know?
Yeah.
Also, this is not allowed. So this is number one. The stones or the things like the stones. طيب. What is the proof that we can use anything other than the stone? Because the Prophet ﷺ specified what is haram. He told us it is not allowed to use the stool, the bone, and the coal. So it means other than these three things?
Allowed.
It is allowed. If you use, as I said, the tissue, the maybe the cotton, these things, this is allowed. But also, again, if you, like the previous point, it is not allowed to use the food. Okay? Because we have to respect the food and the food to eat. And also, some scholars said it is not allowed also to mention something يعني, very smooth, like the glass. Okay, the glass cannot remove the najasa, you cannot remove the dirt by the glass because it is very smooth. Also, they said it's not allowed. Why? Because it isn't used to not clean yourself. Okay? No doubt using the stone or the tissue will not clean you 100%. Maybe it will clean you, maybe 99%. Okay. They say it's this is acceptable. Why? Because of course the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows this. He knows this, alayhi salatu wasalam. But you have to clean yourself until yani. Now the question, if I'm using, I want to use the tissue or I want to use the stone. Okay, until what I clean myself? What is the level? They say until there is something remains which cannot be removed except by water. Okay, yani, no, as I said, no doubt by using the stone, yani, you will not remove 100%. Okay, there is something will remain, maybe as I said, maybe 1%, 2%. Okay, so this is okay. If what remains cannot be removed except by water. Because maybe some people, when they clean, still there is something. They clean, still there is something. Of course, there will be something. Most of the time. Right? So don't worry. And this is okay. This is okay. But you have to make sure that you cannot clean more. You cannot clean more. So this is number one. Number two, I mean by the istinja, is to use the water. To use the water. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also did this hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to the toilet, and me and another boy used to bring the water for him, alayhi salatu wasalam. Then he was cleaning himself by water. كان يستنجي بالماء يستنجي بالماء. طيب. If the stone is allowed and also the water is allowed, which one is better?
Okay.
The water, no doubt. The water. Okay. If I have water, is it a must? Is it compulsory to use the water, or also it is allowed to use the stone? It is allowed. So some people think that the stone only if I don't have water. No, you can use the stone even with water. I mean, even if the water is available, you can use the stone.
But there is an excuse. If there is an excuse, if you cannot use the water, no? If it's so cold, I cannot use it.
You can use the stone. There is excuse or there is no.
Okay,
you can use the water. You can use the tissues. Okay, even if the water is available and it is hot, cold, warm, this is allowed. This is allowed. But which is better? Using the water. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah At-Tawbah, فِيهِ رِجَالٌ يُحِبُّونَ أَن يَتَطَهَّرُوا وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُطَّهِّرِينَ. Allah mentioned about the Masjid Quba. Allah praised the people of Quba. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or the companion said, because they were using water in istinja. They were using the water and cleaning themselves. So Allah praised them because they used the water. So that's why the scholar said it is better to use the water. It's better to use the water. طيب. We do the istinja. Istinja means after the toilet, you use the water or the stone. This is for the urine or after the defecation. Okay. Do we do istinja after passing wind? And if you do this is bid'ah. This is bid'ah. Okay, some people think that, well, after passing wind, I should go to the toilet to clean myself. No, this is bid'ah. Or some people think that if I wake up, yesterday someone told me, I feel if I wake up, I should clean myself before doing wudu. No need. No need. You can wake after sleeping. When you wake up, you can immediately do the wudu and then pray. I know many people think that, no, I have to go to the toilet and to clean myself before doing wudu. Why? Because I was sleeping. So what if you are sleeping? What is the problem? No, خلاص, I have to do this. يعني, my parents, my grandparents, they told me, خلاص, If we wake up and immediately we do the wudu and we pray, they will shock us. So some people think like this. No. The cleaning yourself after the in the toilet, this is only if there is urine or defecation, you have to wash or you have to use the stones. Okay?
Is it bid'ah that if somebody use tissue as well as water both?
No, it is not bid'ah. It is not bid'ah to use the tissue and the water. Yeah, and many scholars, or almost all the scholars, they said it's better to combine. And you use the stone, then the water. Okay, you use the stone, then the water. Or you use the tissue, then the water. There is hadith about the people of Quba. The people of Quba. There is a narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, oh people of Quba, why did Allah mention you in the Quran? Allah praised you in the Quran. Why? What you are doing? They said, "Inna kunna nutbi'u al-hijarat al-ma," because we were using the water after the stone. But this is not authentic narration. This is not authentic narration. Authentic narration because they were using water. But almost all the scholars said it is good to use the stone then the water. Okay, you remove the najasa, you remove the filth by using the tissue, for example, or the stone. Then you use the water. Okay.
Water also 3 times minimum.
No, water only one time. This water one time, not 3 times. So after passing wind, there is no need for the istinja. Is it necessary to every time I want to make wudu, I do before it the istinja? No. No. If you want to make wudu, no need to make the istinja. No need to clean the private part by water. No need. You can do wudu alone. You do the wudu alone. And if you believe that I have to go to the toilet and I wash or I clean by using the tissue or stone, then I can't do the wudu. This is wrong belief. This is wrong belief. They are two separate things. Then there is a chapter regarding the adab al-istinja. What are the manners when we go to the toilet? Number one, don't use your right hand in cleaning yourself. Don't use your right hand. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا يُمْسِكَنَّ أَحَدُكُمْ ذَكَرَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ وَهُوَ يَبُولُ وَلَا يَتَمَسَّحْ مِنَ الْخَلَعَ بِيَمِينِهِ وَلَا يَتَنَفَّسْ فِي الْإِنَاءِ. Don't touch your private part by your right hand when you are urinating. And don't clean by using the right hand. So there are two things in this hadith. Don't touch by using your right hand while urinating. Okay? So some scholars said it means you can't touch by your right hand if you are not urinating. It's okay. Maybe, for example, you want to apply a medicine on your private part. It is okay by using the right hand. But where is the problem, or which one is forbidden? If you are urinating, because the Prophet said, why urinating? And also don't clean by using the right hand. Don't clean yourself by using the right hand when you are in the toilet. When you are in the toilet. So these are two points. Number three, clean your hand. Clean your hand when you are using for the left hand. So clean your left hand after you finish from cleaning yourself, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam masaha yadahu ala al-ard. After he cleaned himself, masaha yadahu ala al-ard. He cleaned by his hand by rubbing on the ground. by rubbing on the ground. Number four, أن ينضح فرجه وسراويله بالماء. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his hadith, توضأ مرة فنضح فرجه. He made wudu صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he spray or sprinkled the water on his private part صلى الله عليه وسلم. طيب, why they say this is يعني this is to stop any kind of waswas, to stop any kind of waswas. يعني many people they say after I'm doing wudu I feel there is one drop of urine or two, three drops of urine. So I go back to the toilet and I check there is nothing. This is maybe Allah from shaitan. So if you have this feeling, yeah, maybe you check yourself one time, two times, three times. So every time you are checking, there is nothing. So using this sunnah will stop. So after you finish urinating and you finish the wudu, okay, you spray the water inside your trouser. So if you have the feeling that I feel drop, no, this is not a drop of urine, this is the water. So khalas, you will close the door in front of the shaitan. So some scholars said this sunnah, okay, you do it if you have this feeling. If you have this feeling. Okay, and subhanAllah, many people have this feeling. Okay, I feel there is urine. When I check, there is nothing. Of course, I'm not talking about the people who have really, there are drops of urine. Okay, for some people, for sure, there is urine. For sure, there is urine. What should you do? You have to wait. You have to wait. Okay, many times I mentioned this point. طيب. After the toilet, some people, still, the urine is coming out. Drops of urine. طيب. Can I make wudu and pray? No, you have to wait. Maybe you need to wait 1 minute. Some people maybe 2 minutes. Some people maybe 10 minutes. Okay? The point is, if you know that the urine will stop, you have to wait until the urine stops, then you pray. Then you pray. But if you have salasal bowl, salasal bowl means the urine doesn't stop. Or the urine comes, you don't know what time. It stops for 1 minute, then it continues for 5 minutes, then again stops. When you don't know, you cannot control yourself. You have a disease, and the urine is coming out all the time. Then you will take the hukum, which is called salasbol. We'll mention this. But if you know that the urine will stop after 10 minutes, you have to wait 10 minutes. Then you make wudu and you pray. If it's not allowed to make wudu before, the najasa stops. You have to wait. You have to wait. Okay, about this problem, the continuous drops of urine. How can we deal? There is hadith. It is not about the urine, but it is about the istihada. Istihada. What does it mean, istihada? It is a disease which makes the woman to bleed. It is not a menstrual period. No, it is a disease that the urine is bleeding. So the Prophet ﷺ told the lady about this situation. إنما ذلك عرق. A lady told the Prophet ﷺ that the blood is coming. Normally, the period is about 6 days, 7 days. Most of the time, or most of the women, 6 or 7 days. Yes, maybe some women 5 days, other women maybe 8 days. But this is the range. This is the range. So 6 to 7 days. But if the blood is coming out 15, 16, 17, 1 month, continuous, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the lady, "Inna madaliki irq." What is the meaning, "Inna madaliki irq"? It means a vessel. It means the menstrual blood is a normal, natural blood, which comes from the uterine. They say that the scholars say that, yani, if you remember in the school, you studied the menstrual circle, blood circle, okay? The egg of the woman, the yib, there are two ovaries. And every, the ovary will release one egg every 2 months, because two ovaries, so every ovary, every 2 months. So this month, this ovary, the second month, the other ovary. So monthly, yes, there is one egg. So the body will prepare for the baby. They say the menstrual period, the blood of the menstrual period, is the food of the baby. But if there is no baby, the blood will go out. So that's why, how the women know that they are pregnant? If there is no blood, it means the blood will stay for the baby. So this is normal blood, this is natural blood. It is from the uterine. But if there is an injury in one of the vessels, so there will be bleeding. Okay? Not during the menstrual time period. It will be continuous. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna madaliki irq." This is an injury in a vessel. And that's why the color of the blood is different. The menstrual period blood, inshallah, there is a chapter about the hayd, the menstrual period. Okay, this the blood of the natural blood of the menstrual period is darker and it is thick and it has different smell. But the istihada, okay, the bleeding by the vessel, it is fresh blood. And light, and also the color, not dark color. So different criteria, usually. So the Prophet said, "Inna madalik irq." He told that lady who asked about this bleeding, this is irq. It is not the natural blood. It is because of a disease. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Walaysat bil hayda." And this is not the period. So if you're period comes, you have to stop the salah. فَإِذَا أَقْبَلَتِ الْحَيْضَ فَدَعِ الصَّلَاةِ. If the blood of the menstrual period comes, you have to stop the salah. فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ قَدْرُهَا. And when it finishes the time of the normal menstrual period, okay, فَغْسِلِ عَنْكِ الدَّمْ وَصَلِّي. Wash this kind of blood and pray. It means clean yourself and take the shower, ghusl, and pray. And pray. There is a narration. ثُمَّ تَوَضَّئِ لِكُلِّ صَلَاةٍ. Then make wudu for every salah. Make wudu for every salah. And this narration in Bukhari. I mean, the last part, the whole hadith in Bukhari. But the last part, make wudu, when the Prophet ﷺ said, make wudu for every salah. It means wudu for the fajr, and another wudu for dhuhr, a third wudu for asr. So every day you have to make wudu at least 5 times. So the scholars differ. This last part of the hadith, is it a saying from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or it is an opinion from one of the narrators of the hadith? So for those scholars who say, no, this is part of the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, then they say, if you have this problem, I mean the continuous dropping of the urine or the bleeding of in the menstrual period, then you have to make wudu for every salah. Of course, what does it mean for every salah? For every fard salah. For every fard salah. It doesn't mean for every salah. It means, yani, before dhuhr you want to pray sunnah. You pray two rak'ah, then you go and make wudu. Then you pray the other two rak'ah before dhuhr, and you make wudu. Then you make wudu for the fard. Then you make wudu for the two rak'ah after dhuhr. No. It means for every time of our salah. And for the scholars who said, no, this is from a tabi'i or from one of the narrators, they say it is not wajib to make wudu for every salah. You make wudu if you have anything invalidates your wudu, like passing wind, like urinating, then you make, or you, after sleeping, you make wudu. Well, to be safe, we tell the person to make wudu for every salah. And yani, usually it is not difficult. Usually it is not difficult. Okay, yes. Because duha is not in the time of fajr, and also it is not the time, yani, you do the wudu for duha, because it is not a time for fajr and it is not time for dhuhr. But qiyam al layl, it is time for isha.
If you delay it to the last third.
According to majority of scholars, you use the same wudu. Because majority of scholars said isha up to the fajr. This will come inshallah. But major scholars say the Isha, Jumhur, they say the Isha up to the Fajr. The timing of Isha is up to the Fajr. But yeah, no doubt if you make wudu, if you make wudu for every salah, this is a safer opinion.
At least one time.
Sorry?
For each salah, Sunnah, you said in the last class, once. Wudu, not three times, one time.
Yes, yes. Yes, you mean to wash the hand one time at least. Yes, this is enough. And during the wudu, you wash one time. You wash your face one time, the arms one time. This is one time is enough. Minimum. And also, we tell the person, yani, to find a treatment. Okay, yani, this is a problem. This is a problem. This is a disease. So, go to the doctor and check what is the problem and find treatment. And the drops, usually this, the drops of urine after the toilet, okay, this can happen because of the weakness in the muscle. Or sometimes there is a problem in the prostate. Especially the old people, after maybe 65, usually the prostate, there is hypertrophy, the prostate becomes big. So if it is big, it can affect the bladder, and it pushes, and the urine comes without control. طيب. So I mean, this is a medical problem. So you have to check what is the problem, and to find a treatment, because this is important for the salah. It is important for the salah. Also, one of the manners of the toilet that. You have to cover yourself. I mean, you have to cover your awrah from the people. You have to cover your awrah. طيب. Jabir ibn Abdullah said, radiallahu ta'ala an, we went with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a safar. We were traveling with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hiding himself when he goes to the toilet. يعني, of course, they don't have the toilet like our toilet, but when they want qada al-haja, what's in qada al-haja? To urinate or to defecate. He used to hide himself, to go far, to hide himself by going far. Alayhi salatu wassalam. So this is very important to protect your awra, to cover your awra. Nowadays, you have this. On the wall, this toilet.
Uriner.
Is it allowed or not allowed? يعني, some people know this is haram, this is the way of the kuffar. يعني, we have to be careful. يعني, don't say for something haram only because it is from the kuffar. يعني, the scholars mention. The Prophet ﷺ, if he wants to urinate, maybe he urinate in a place not far from the companions. You will be close to them, near to them, but no doubt covering his awrah. But for defecating, no, he will go away. He will be far. So for urinating, number one, can I do this in the surroundings? Yes. But you have to be careful about the awrah. This is number one. This is number one, yani about the urinal. Can I do it in the urinal? Yes, if it is cover, if you are covering your aura, yani there is a curtain or there is partition to make sure that you are covering your aura. This is number one. Number two, it is designed in a way to protect yourself from the
drops
of urine. Okay, you have to make sure that the urine will not come on your clothes. This is very important. Okay, but some people say, but this is not allowed because you are standing.
Yeah.
No, this is allowed because the Prophet said he did. He urinated while standing. It is allowed. It is allowed when you are sure that your aura is covered and the urine is not touching you, your body or your clothes. So using this way is allowed, but if you are sure that people are not watching you and also you are not watching people and the urine is not touching your body. Okay, there is hadith, maybe people sometimes, usually it is not only one. There are 3, 4, 6, صح, together. Okay, so suppose they are covered, there is curtain, or there is partition. But usually the partition is not tall, it is short. صح? So maybe people chat. Is it allowed or not? Because talking during the صح ولا لا؟ Okay. Is it allowed or not? Is it allowed or not? So this is one of the points. Can we talk during the toilet or not? Some scholars say this is not allowed. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not answer the salam. Did not reply the salam. Someone gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam salam, and he was urinating, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not reply. Then he told him, I did not answer you because I was urinating. So some scholars said, replying the salam is wajib or mustahab? If someone said salam, you have to reply. One of the gathering. So if you are alone, so you are the only one there, you have to reply. So they said, the Prophet ﷺ did not answer the wajib, so it means it is haram to speak. It is haram. But some scholars said, to make it general, this is not true. To say it is not allowed to speak. The hadith specifically about the salam. The hadith is about the salam. So this is number one. Number two, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inni karihat an adhkura Allah illa ala tuhr." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "I dislike to remember Allah, because saying wa alaykum salam is dhikr, صح? To say wa alaykum salam, this is dhikr. Why it is dhikr? Because wasn't wa alaykum salam? It means I'm making du'a for you. It means I'm making du'a." Peace be upon you. This is dua for you. So it is a kind of dhikr. So the dhikr is makruh. The hadith means it is makruh, not haram. So what should be avoided? Any kind of speech or only the dhikr? Dhikr. Dhikr. And also, the hadith is about while the process. Now our toilets, not only for the urinating, it is to make the wudu, to take a shower, to brush your teeth, for many things. So if you are urinating, then we tell you don't answer the salam. But you are inside the toilet taking shower. Yes, it is allowed to talk, even to say wa alaykum as-salam. Or if the muaddin is giving the adhan and I'm taking shower, okay, is it allowed to say the adhkar of adhan? I say with the muaddin, Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu muhammadar rasulullah, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Is it allowed? Yes, it is allowed. Yes, it is allowed. Why? Because the hadith is about urinating. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inni karihtu an adhkura Allah illa ala tur." I know you are in the bathroom. As I said, nowadays it is not like before. The bathroom now it is for
multi-purpose.
Maybe people do their business inside there.
Yes. Right? Mobile phone.
The mobile is right. Maybe the office, huh? Inside. You escape from your family inside the toilet. Sheikh Al-Bani rahimahullah mentioned a narration, very clear narration. The Prophet ﷺ told the man, if you see me doing this, don't give me salam because I will not answer you. So it means it is only when you are urinating or but after you finish and you clean yourself, then you are making wudu or you want to take shower, then it is okay. Then it is not included in the hadith.
When you use those facilities to urinate standing, it's basically difficult to clean yourself because there's no water.
Tissue.
Even tissue.
if they are not providing, yes, maybe they are not providing a way to clean yourself.
You have to take special.
The point is sometimes you are not going to pray. Okay, it is not a time of salah. Okay, then you go home and you clean yourself. It is not wajib now I clean myself. Maybe there is a drop of urine or 2-3 drops of urine after that. Okay, you are dropping on the tayyib, but I'm not going to pray. You are at work or you are in a place and this is the only one which is available and I'm not going to pray now. Okay, urinate, and if you cannot clean yourself, then it is okay. But later when you go home, you have to clean yourself and you have to change your clothes or you have to wash. Of course, no doubt, priority, we tell you, clean yourself. But as you said, there is no facilities. Okay, what can I do? Of course, if I'm going to pray, I have to clean. But if it is not the time of prayer, I'm not praying now. I will pray later. For example, I finished the work 2 p.m. and Asr Salah 3:30. For example, when I go home, I clean myself. And of course, I change or I wash my trouser. Tayyib?
About the toilet, some scholars have this opinion that you should not talk, while in the toilet.
Why? Because the hadith, they said, if the Prophet ﷺ did not answer the salam, they said, answering the salam is wajib. So the Prophet ﷺ did not answer the salam. So the Prophet ﷺ did not do the wajib. So if he did not do the wajib, it means talking in the toilet is haram, strictly forbidden. Okay? But as I said, other scholars said, the Prophet ﷺ did not answer the salam. Why? Because he disliked to make dhikr. So the point of making this forbidden, the dhikr, not any normal talk. So, for example, someone told you, where is the key of the car? You can't tell him the key of the car inside my dishdasha, it is on the table. You can't answer. You can't answer.
Or if your wife calls you.
If you are your wife, you have to stand up and you have to answer and you have to wait. Why you mention the wife? Today I did not mention, but you. Also, one of the manners, don't take something which includes the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like, there is a famous hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to the toilet, or when he used to go to the toilet, he used to remove his ring. And what is written on the ring? Muhammad Rasulullah. But this is not authentic hadith. But they say, generally speaking, we have to respect the name of Allah. We have to respect the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if it is possible, you keep the things which include the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, the names of Allah, you remove. But specifically the Mus'haf, okay, and it's going to say, this is haram. You take it with you inside the toilet, this is haram. Yes, we don't have a hadith, don't take the Mus'haf with you. But yani, no doubt, if you take a book with you inside the toilet, it is a mean of not respecting. صح? What is the meaning of that, a book or something with you inside the toilet? It means it is not respect. Okay, so no doubt for the Mus'haf, this is haram. This is haram. You have to keep the Mus'haf outside. Keep the Mus'haf outside. But maybe some people say, if I keep it outside, the people, they will steal the Mus'haf. Then it's okay. If your friend is with you, khalas, keep it with your friend. Or keep it in the car or something. But if there is no way, maybe you are in an airport and they steal everything. Okay, so khalas, keep it with you. Inside, keep it with you. But generally speaking, you have to avoid taking the Mus'haf inside the toilet. Also, one of the manners, saying Bismillah and saying Isti'adah. Isti'adah. Saying Bismillah is not something for the toilet specifically. Saying Bismillah is before taking your removing your clothes in the toilet or in the room. If you want to change, طيب, say Bismillah. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "A sitter. What is the sitter? What is the barrier between you and the jinn?
Bismillah.
To say Bismillah." What is the barrier between me and the people? To go inside the room and I close the door. But what is the sitter, what is the barrier between me and the jinn? Is to say Bismillah. When you say Bismillah, they cannot see you. They cannot see you, your awra. طيب? So you say Bismillah. And also you say, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الخبث والخبائث before the toilet. This is Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after you finish, you say غفرانك. You say غفرانك.
Shaykh, is this before entering the toilet or even after you enter, you can say this dua before you start?
يعني this course mentioned this before you enter the toilet, but as I mentioned, at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there was no, the toilets were not known. So it is before you urinate. Yeah, for example, if you are in an open place, there is no toilet. Okay, when I should say, Allahumma ni'udhu bika al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith, before you start, you say, Allahumma ni'udhu bika al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. When I say Bismillah, before removing your clothes.
Because usually when we teach the boys in the Rabbani, that's
this is to make it easy for them. Yani, you know, teaching, especially the boys, if you tell them before removing your clothes and before urinating, it will be difficult for them. Maybe difficult. So you tell them to make it easy for them. Before you enter the toilet, say Bismillah. Say Allahumma ni'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. Just to make it easy for them. But for example,
if you forget while going in, then you can say it inside.
Even without forgetting. If after I enter and I close the door, I lock the door, I say Bismillah, it's okay. Because the point is before removing your clothes, before urinating, you say Allahumma ya'ud kubtay wa khaba'at. Also, it is common to enter the toilet by using the by starting with the left leg, foot. There is no proof. There is no proof. But almost all the scholars said this is mustahab. Why? Because this is opposite to the masjid. They say because there is hadith. It is sunnah. Anas said it is sunnah when you enter the masjid to start with the right leg. So they say the toilet is opposite the masjid. So for the toilet, you start with the left. Okay? You start with the left. But we have to be careful. Sometimes the shoes or the slipper of the toilet is inside. So some people, they say, I want to enter with my left leg. So when they start wearing the shoes, they start with the left. No, this is wrong. Why? Because we have a clear hadith. If you want to put the shoes or the slipper, you start with the right. Okay? So this is a clear sunnah. This is a clear sunnah. So start with the right foot in this case.
Can we say all the good things what we do, we need to start with the right and left is all bad things? Can we generalize that?
They mentioned, Nawawi Rahimahullah said, this is, he said, it is a general rule. For the good things, you start with the right. And with the dirty or the dislike thing, you start with the left. This is a rule. This is a rule. Point of facing the Qibla. Facing the Qibla. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you come to the toilet, don't face the Qibla and don't give your back to the Qibla. Go to the Shariqu aw Gharribu, to the east or to the west. Why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, go to the east or west? Because he was in Medina. And where is the Qibla?
South.
طيب. So you should go to the east or the west. But for example, if you are in India?
Kerala.
Kerala. Specifically Kerala?
South.
Okay. Where is Makkah if you are in India?
West.
So if you are in India, we don't tell you go to the east or west.
No,
it is, yes, it is different. Or if you are in Morocco, not Morocco, Nigeria?
Turkey.
No, not Turkey. In the middle of Africa. Okay? Where is the Qibla?
East.
So, of course, we don't tell you go to the east or west. Or if you are in South America, you have to go to the north or south. So the point, don't go to, toward the Qibla or at the back. So this hadith is clear. Don't.
It's only for open space.
Sorry?
It's for open space.
And this hadith where? This hadith in Bukhari. This hadith in Bukhari. Also, there is another hadith in Bukhari. Abdullah ibn Umar, he said, I saw the Prophet ﷺ, his back toward the Qibla. And also, Jabir ibn Abdullah said, I saw the Prophet ﷺ before his death in 1 year, okay, facing the Qibla and urinating. So now, this is a problem. The Prophet ﷺ said, don't face the Qibla or give your back to the Qibla. And now, these two hadith he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The scholars mentioned 4 opinions. And some of them said 7 opinions about how to join between these ahadith. Some scholars said, some scholars said it took the first hadith, so it is not allowed. Al-Aswa said, took the second and the third hadith, and they said, okay, and the other scholar said, it is allowed. They took the second hadith. And another group, they said, no, we have to use that, the hadith. Basically, if you have two hadith, which you think they are contradicting, don't cancel one hadith. At the beginning, you have to try to join. Of course, if they are authentic hadith, at the beginning, you have to make sure. Are they authentic or not? And here in this case, both of them in Bukhari. Both of them in Bukhari. So, should I use one and I cancel the other? At the beginning, I tell you, you have to join. If there is a way to join, to use both of them, you have to use both of them. Okay. How can we use both of them? Okay. Some scholars said, we use both of them by saying it is not allowed if you are in open place and it is allowed if you are in a closed place. But other scholars said the second hadith, he was not in a closed place, he was in open place. Hadith Jabir. So maybe, wallahu alam, the one with the strong opinion, we say it is makruh. It is makruh. Some scholars said it is makruh to face the Qibla. To face the Qibla, or you'll give your back to the Qibla, this is makruh. Why? Because there's hadith say, don't do. And we have a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ did. So, if you remember many times we mentioned, if it is haram, if there is a saying, it means it is haram. I mean, if there is a saying from the Prophet ﷺ, don't do, then it is haram. But if you have an action that the Prophet ﷺ did, so it will make it from haram to makruh. It will take it from haram to makruh. طيب. So, يعني والله أعلم, this is a strong opinion to say that it is makruh. That it is makruh. And no doubt, يعني, when it is indoor, it is inside a closed place. يعني, this is the opinion of Ibn Umar. The opinion of Abdullah ibn Umar, if you are in a closed place, then it's okay. Or if there is a barrier between you and the Qibla, then it is okay. يعني, there is hadith, some scholars say this is authentic hadith, that someone told Ibn Umar, why you are doing this? This is forbidden. Ibn Umar said, no, if there was a camel. There is a camel between him and the Qibla. He said, no, if there is something between you and the Qibla, then it is okay. Then it is okay. Okay? So, we'll continue, inshallah, next week, this chapter. JazakAllah khair. Yes?